Or like, this department has like some social event.
Okay, everyone, welcome to the first talk of this semester of GSS. Like you know, I just dethroned Kevin. Andy would tell us about
extremely disconnected spaces.
Yes, something about the biology. Okay,
right. Thank you, sir.
I need to tell you that Andy just received the NSF postdoc award, so let's congratulate him.
Thanks for the kind introduction. So I'm going to tell you about extremal, so it has some extremal property. Extremely disconnected spaces. That's actually kind of a lie because I'm going to talk way more about complete Boolean algebras. But we're going to see why those are not totally unrelated. So some preliminaries. I'm going to assume people know what a compact Hausdorff space is. I'm also going to assume, maybe a little bit less assume, but I'm not going to talk too much about what a Boolean algebra is. If you don't know what a Boolean algebra is, think about the collection of subsets of a given ambient set. That's a good example. And then take the sort of the finitistic properties that that has. So you can union two things together. You can intersect two things. Union distributes over intersection. You can complement things. So that's roughly what a Boolean algebra is. And what are we going to do? I should tell you what an extremely disconnected space is. Define an EDS. Most of my extremely disconnected spaces are going to, in fact, be compact extremely disconnected spaces. Everything is Hausdorff. I will probably stop saying Hausdorff. Look at applications in topology, dynamics, and logic. Because these spaces are cool, they show up everywhere. All right, so this is the outline of the talk. I may do some subset of this. I might get tired at 6:30 and say, let's go home, we'll see what happens. All right.
You can do a second talk.
A series. I don't think, I feel like I might get voted out after this one. We'll see how it goes. So, as a warm-up idea to extremely disconnected, there's a less extremal notion called totally disconnected, or sometimes called zero-dimensional. Those are synonyms. So, a compact Hausdorff space X is zero-dimensional. A synonym for zero-dimensional is totally disconnected. If base of Clopen sets. So that's pretty, disconnected means you have a non-trivial Clopen set. So totally disconnected, we have lots and lots and lots of Clopen sets, enough that they actually describe the topology. Some really simple examples. Cantor space is a great example. Take the compact space with 2 points, just the discrete topology, and take the big product. That's probably a pretty familiar example. But compactness, I mean, we can take arbitrary products of the compact space. So I could put some bigger cardinal kappa up here if I wanted to. And that would also be totally disconnected. So just, these exist. Let me actually put this down here. So if X is zero-dimensional, let's say, I'm often going to even omit compact too, so like most of the spaces I talk about are going to be compact and Hausdorff. So if X is a compact Hausdorff zero-dimensional space, it has lots of Clopins, let's give that a name, Clop X equals Clopins. Alright, so remark. So I told you we'd be working with Boolean algebras a lot. Well, here's our first one. Clop X is a Boolean algebra. Sorry, my chalk is so transparent. I'll try to. There we go. Clop X is a Boolean algebra. And even simpler, so to define a Boolean algebra, you need to define the meet operator. Meet is just going to be intersection. Union is just going, or wedge is just going to be union. Complement is just complement in the space. Because things are Clopin, that's also Clopin. The zero, empty set, and the one is the whole space. And then since the operations are just the normal set theory operation, there's nothing to verify. This is a Boolean algebra for free. Alright, so we started with a compact zero-dimensional space, and we get a Boolean algebra for free. Now, someone hands us a Boolean algebra, what's going to happen? Well, conversely, suppose B is a Boolean algebra. I might just write BA for Boolean algebra. It would be nice if all Boolean algebras were of the form Clop X for some zero-dimensional compact space. That would be a really cool theorem, maybe Stone's theorem. So we're gonna prove Stone's representation theorem. So we need to construct a compact zero-dimensional space that gives us. If you've seen me give a GSS talk before, you might anticipate that I'm about to define an ultra filter of some sort. So a filter on Boolean algebra is a subset of Boolean algebra with properties 1, 2, 3, and maybe not 4. I'll explain what 4 is doing in a little bit. 1 are just basic non-trivialities. The whole thing is in there. The 0 is not allowed to be in there. It's upward closed. It's closed under finite intersections, which are finite applications of wedge, close, or not wedge, meet, close under finite meets. So if you have 1 through 3, you get a filter. 4 is a bonus property. The bonus property 4 is that for every A in the Boolean algebra, either A is in or the complement is in. So if 4, we get what's called an ultra filter. A filter, and then how do we know? I mean, so filters exist. Just take any set and upwards close it. That'll be a filter. It's not quite so clear that ultra filters should exist, but they do once we observe the following. So a filter is ultra if and only if, let's call the filter F. F is a maximal filter. So if you want a maximal filter, just start with any filter in Poisson's lemma. You can get a maximal filter containing the filter you started with. So, ultra filters exist, and let's give the collection of ultra filters a name. So let ST be, this is ST for stone, the stone space of B. Stone space of B. On B, we should give the stone space of B some sort of useful topology, a typical basic Clopin set is form. With the Boolean algebra, we obtained a collection of points. We gave that collection of points some interesting topology. So I told you typical basic Clopin. So why are these Clopin? Well, an ultrafilter has to contain A or A complement. So the complement of this is just replace A with A complement here, and that's going to be of this form also. So these things are all Clopin. You get a topology. I told you that these are basic, so it's zero-dimensional. It actually ends up being compact. Why is it? I'm not going to write down a proof, but let's think about how 4 is going to bias compactness. If I have, let's have an open cover of basic open sets. And I get, actually, let me write this down. This is useful. Just to see once how this sort of argument works. STB is compact Hausdorff. Hausdorffness is clear. If I have two different ultrafilters they're going to disagree on something. And that's a clopen containing this one. The complement clopen containing this one, those are disjoint open sets. So how does it work? Why is it compact? Say that let me give this a name also. This will be U sub A. That's the basic open set corresponding to A. Say that U sub A I is open cover. If we do this, if there is no finite subcover, there I had to throw in an extra negation, so here's the extra negation, then the negations of all these sets is a filter. Just because I told you it wasn't a finite subcover. So these negations, if finitely many of the negations failed to meet, that would mean that their complements covered the whole space. So now why is that bad? Extend to some space. And then this Q, this Q cannot have been covered. Q is not covered. And that's a contradiction. Alright, so what have we done? We have zero-dimensional compact spaces give us Boolean algebras. Boolean algebras give us zero-dimensional compact spaces. I should note that there are some nice, here's a quick remark. So I have the operator, if I start with X, I can hit it with the clop operator. It's really a functor, clop functor. And then I can hit clop with the stone functor. What should I get? I should get what I started with. And similarly, if I start with a Boolean algebra, I hit it with the stone map, and then I hit that with the clop map, I'm going to get an isomorphic algebra. Both of these arguments, you need a little bit of compactness to make it work. Like, there's sort of an obvious, for instance, there's an obvious inclusion of B into here. You need to argue that everything gets landed on, and that's a bit of a compactness argument. There's an obvious map from the stone space of the clopens into X, and you need to argue it's injective, and that will get used a bit of practice. Alright. So, where is my... Okay. So, these are totally disconnected. Let's make it extreme. So here's the main definition. Definition. A compact Hausdorff space X is extremely disconnected. this is going to sound like a really weird definition. And it is, because it's a really weird property of spaces. If the closure of every open set is open. So that's weird. That's another example that there are lots of, it would certainly appear that there are lots of clopen sets, if I can obtain one just by closing off whatever open set I start with. Let me draw a picture to convince you that these are zero-dimensional. If X is compact, chain is connected, then you get zero-dimensional. This chunk is failing me. And why is that? If I have a, here's my space, here's a point, here's an open neighborhood, I want to argue that there's a base of clopen sets. I need to put a clopen around this. Well, compact Hausdorff spaces are normal, so certainly regular. I can put an open set here, V, whose closure is contained. Find V with V bar subset of U. That's just any compact space will do that. But then closures of open sets are clopen. So that's a quick argument that we actually get zero-dimensional spaces when we do this. Let's see, I'm trying to think. So before, you might ask for, let me give a non-example of a, I want to erase this. So, I can't give you any examples quite yet because we need another characterization of what it means to be extremely disconnected to know that they're going to exist, or to have an easy proof that something that we come across is extremely disconnected. But here's a non-existence proof. Example, Cantor space 2 to the omega is not extremely disconnected. So I'm going to write down I wrote down a nice example somewhere. Here we go. So if I have a finite string, which goes a basic neighborhood, n sub s is the neighborhood x in Cantor space, x starts off with s, this is a typical basic clopen neighborhood of Cantor space, and I'm going to let, let's consider the open set U. This will be the union over K and the natural numbers of N 1 0 to the 2K plus 1 1. So what is this? So I'm looking at strings with a 1, an odd number of zeros, and then a 1, and the corresponding basic neighborhoods, and then just uniting them up, that's open. So then, I want to show that the closure is not open. I claim that it's just going to be U union the string. So I mean, the only cluster point that's not in one of these things already is just if we kind of zoom off and let the zeros in the middle get longer and longer, we're going to get the string 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. But then this is closed. And now, but note, but 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 is not in n sub 1. That's not enough. It's not in the interior of U closure. So there's no open ball I can put around the string to stay inside U closure. Because for instance, an open ball is like string starting with 1 and some number of zeros. Extend that so that there's an even number of zeros. We're never going to be able to pick up things with an even number of zeros. That's just not. They're not there.
I don't understand that notation actually with that S.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay, so Cantor space is just strings of zeros and ones going off to the right. This is a finite string of zeros and ones. So these are the strings that start with the specified finite string. So I can take the finite string, so maybe like 101, and then maybe extend it to 101. That's my S. And then I extend it however I want. And I get an element of Cantor space.
Andy, do you need the first one in these?
I guess not. Yeah, the key thing is the last thing. You're right. You don't need the first one. So we've isolated something that's definitely stronger than zero-dimensional. We've exhibited a zero-dimensional space that is not extremely disconnected. So it's probably a good idea to convince you that this isn't a vacuous notion. So let's actually build an extremely disconnected space. And what we're going to do is we're going to use Stone duality and isolate a property of the Boolean algebra that tells us when a space is extremely disconnected. Script A is a subset of the Boolean algebra, and C is some other element, then C is an upper bound for A, if and only if C is above normal A for every A in script A. This will have a very kind of almost like a real analysis flavor. Maybe a completeness flavor, because this is just completeness. C is a least upper bound. If it is upper, least upper bound, and it's below all other upper bounds. So as it stands, I mean, there's no guarantee that, every set has an upper bound 1, the whole thing is an upper bound for every subset of Boolean algebra. But there's no guarantee that least upper bounds exist. So we were going to define a property of definition. A Boolean algebra B is complete if every subset has a subset. Have two elements which are least upper bounds for the same set script A, well, each is below the other, so they are equal. Least upper bound is unique. And I'll just denote it with a giant wedge in front of the set. So that's the least upper bound of the collection A. It's an element of B. And there is a reason I defined this. The proposition is let X be compact Hausdorff zero-dimensional. So we're in a setting where we can use Stone, we have access to Stone's theorem, we have access to the Boolean algebra of Clopen sets, and we're going to characterize extreme disconnectedness. X is extremely disconnected, and sort of the obvious thing given that I just spent time defining this extra property that the Boolean algebra might have, we want it to be complete. And the proof actually isn't too bad. It's just a matter of writing down the thing you sort of have to write down. So, proof that one implies two. If X is ED and A subset of Clopens. So I want a candidate for the wedge. Well, the wedge had better contain the union, some Clopen set that contains every Clopen set in A, it better contain the union. That might not be this is open, certainly, but it's not Clopen. But wait, the closures of open sets are open. That's, and then it's really easy to check that this works. Two implies one. Let's see. If co-op is complete, and let's say that U is an open subset of X, well, we need to get our hands on some collection of Clopens in the Boolean algebra, and there's an obvious candidate. A, these will be the Clopens. So that A is a subset of U. We're going to let C. Yeah, this is the direction that takes a tiny bit more work, not too much. So this is a subset of our Boolean algebra. It has a wedge. So let's, just for notational clarity, C will equal wedge A. C is a Clopen, it seems like a decent candidate. We're trying to argue something about the closure of U. We want the closure of U to be open. So let's try to argue. We're going to argue we want that C is equal to U closure. That would certainly work if we can do this. So certainly, C contains U closure. C contains every clopen. So if I just take the union of A, that is U. It's just the union of all the basic clopen sets inside the open set. So if I take the union, I recover U. C has to contain U. C is closed. C will contain the closure. Other way around, if C less U bar were non-empty, well, then it's a non-empty open set, so let A clock X, A non-empty, with a subset of C less U bar, then C less A is an upper bound for the collection script A. But that's crazy. This is a smaller upper bound than the least one, so that's not going to work. So we get this equality. All right, so now we've used stone duality to give us a Boolean algebra characterization of extreme disconnectedness. So now, this is where I kind of have to confess that the talk might not be about extremely disconnected spaces as much. I'm going to start talking a lot about complete Boolean algebras. And in particular, we can use them to get some examples. So, what's the simplest example? Alright, well, finite discrete spaces are kind of boring. What's the simplest interesting example? So, example, the power set of the natural numbers is a complete Boolean algebra. Often use just CBA for complete Boolean algebra. So, the stone space is extremely disconnected. But this has a much more common name. This is just beta omega. This is the space of ultrafilters the space of ultrafilters over omega. It's an ultrafilter on this Boolean algebra. So that's pretty easy. Here is a slightly more interesting one, maybe to bring in some analysis. Another example. So let's consider the unit interval. Unit interval 0, 1. With lambda the Lebesgue measure. And let's consider the measure algebra. Mal lambda. This is the measure algebra Borel mod null. So certainly we know this is a Boolean algebra, just because the Borels are a Boolean algebra, and the set theory operations respect the ideal. We know a few things just because of the null ideal. We know that, for instance, the measure algebra is countably complete. Any countable collection is going to have an upper bound, just because I can take the union of those countably many Borel sets and how do we turn countable additivity into completeness? We need a little bit extra to actually get full completeness. So here is the quick fact. Malg is what's known as CCC. Any collection of pairwise incomparable. I'm going to call two elements of Boolean algebra incomparable if their meat is empty. Where is incomparable elements is at most countable. So why is this fact true in the measure algebra case? Well, I have this collection of Borel sets, pairwise intersections are null, but I know that the everything in the collection is positive, and it has a positive measure. So we're going to run into problems if I have uncountably many things of positive measure with pairwise null intersection. That's just ridiculous. That can't happen. So we get this property that Malg has. And then here's, we're going to tie it together, the quick proposition. If a Boolean algebra B is countably complete and CCC, then it is complete. Let me sketch the proof. I don't want to spend too much time on this proof because I want to focus on my third and final example. What if I wanted to find the upper bound of a collection of size aleph 1? So, proof sketch. Let A be a collection of omega 1 many. This is the first uncountable ordinal. So I have uncountably many elements of this Boolean algebra. I want a least upper bound. What we're going to do is I'm going to truncate these collections. So A gamma are going to just be the A alphas for alpha less than gamma, where gamma well, each of these, well, now what's going on, these are all, these are countable ordinals. So these are countable collections. So by assumption, this wedge exists. So now we have an increasing, each of these is increasing because I'm throwing more and more sets from my original collection in. It's growing. I want to argue that it stops growing before the end. Well, if it kept growing, you'd have uncountably many sort of jumps in growth. But that sure looks like an uncountable antichain. That's a problem to our assumption that our antichains are all countable. So anyways, that provides, in some sense, another example of a compact, extremely disconnected space. You take the stone space in this, but in practice, people don't really do that, and you just work with the measure algebra because this is pretty well understood. All right, the last example is taking a bit longer than I had hoped, so I might not do as much forcing as I said, but I don't think anyone is too heartbroken. Sorry, Jane. I want to talk about regular open algebras, because this shows up in topology all the time. So I'm going to relax my convention that spaces are compact by default. So let X be any Hausdorff space. I don't even know if you need Hausdorff. I just throw it in because I don't like thinking about non-Hausdorff spaces. Any Hausdorff space. In fact, I don't think you need Hausdorff. But anyway, subset is regular open. Certainly you get the left to right inclusion for free. It's the reverse makes this an interesting definition. The fact that you recover exactly U and not some bonus stuff also. For let RO be a collection of regular open sets. We are going to turn RO into a Boolean algebra as follows. So notice I'm being kind of careful with how I'm phrasing this. I'm not saying that RO is a Boolean algebra. I'm saying we have to turn it into a Boolean algebra. Namely, the ordinary set theory operations are not going to work. For instance, the complement of my regular open set might not be open. The union of two regular open sets might not be regular open. So you have to tweak the ordinary operations, and then you have to argue that your definition actually works if you get a Boolean algebra. So here are the definitions. The meat is just going to be the ordinary intersection. The wedge is a little trickier. So you want to write down union V. You want to write down this, but it might not work. So you take its closure and you take the interior. The complement. You want to take the complement, but that might not be open at all. So you take the interior of this. And then you argue, you have to argue that this works. So there's a few ways of seeing that. One is to just brute force your way through the axioms of what makes a Boolean algebra. Distributivity is really annoying if you do it that way. Maybe a slightly easier way of thinking about it is put all the open sets into equivalence classes, and then each equivalence class, based on having the same regular open representative. So if I start with any U and I form this, you get the regular open. Form equivalence classes based on having the same output. And then each of those is going to have a canonical regular open representative. And so then you just do the ordinary operations on any open set, but then pass to the representative again. That's another way of, that simplifies some of the proofs. You still have to deal with complements. No way around dealing with complements. That's annoying. But it works. So what is nice about RO is it's a complete Boolean algebra proposition. ROX is complete. proof is actually really easy. I mean, the hard part is checking it's a Boolean algebra in the first place, which I'm sweeping under the rug. But if we assume it's a Boolean algebra, so we're going to let A be a subset of ROX. We set the wedge to be the interior of the closure of the union. So certainly it is. This is certainly an upper bound. It's certainly regular open because it's this is just the regular open operation. So what if we had another upper bound? So let's write, let me call this union U. So if C is an upper bound, so C is some, let's say C is an ROX, it's a regular open set. U must be a subset of C. So let's just do the regular open operation. So close these off, you maintain the same inclusion. And then put interiors in front of that, you maintain the same inclusion. And that's the direction that you needed to show. So that this is a smaller upper bound than this one. Alright, so now we have lots and lots of examples because there are lots and lots of Hausdorff topological spaces out there. So namely, we can revisit, it might be worthwhile to revisit the example from earlier when I showed you that Cantor space was not extremely disconnected. So what do we have? We know that if I look at Cantor space, Cantor space has a Boolean algebra, so let's let B equal, actually let's just let B be any Boolean algebra. This is a general statement. Let me do this more. So we plot the omega. I can take the stone space of this, i.e. 2 the omega, versus RO of 2 to the omega. These seem like they should be pretty similar. This is complete, this is not, but how can we, what's the relation? So I want to find every clopen lives here. Clopen's a regular open. And that's going to turn out to be a very special map. So in general, if B is any Boolean algebra, we can embed B, so be a map from B into regular open of the stone space of B. Why is that? Well, every member of B is a describes a clopen subset of this, and so is regular open. So we're just going to include it in that sense. IB is an embedding with dense image. What does dense image mean in this context? It means given any member of the target Boolean algebra, there's something from the domain that maps below. So given, let's say U, subset of RO of this regular open stone space of B, also U is an element of. So U is just some open subset of stone B. Let's find a clopen A subset of U by stone duality. By stone duality, A has to come from our Boolean algebra. And it turns out that this is rather canonical. So we can call this the completion of the Boolean algebra B. And there's only one completion. There are going to be any two completions are going to be isomorphic. So that's something that's nice to know. If you are a Boolean algebra, you can make yourself a complete Boolean algebra without doing too much work. I have a few more minutes, so I'll take a vote. I have two applications I wanted to present. I probably have time for one of them, or zero of them. That's an option. So I have a kind of dynamical interpretation or the set theoretic application. Or nothing.
Does set theory mean forcing?
It does.
I vote dynamic.
Okay. Joe seems to be the only voter. So what is a good application? This application is called building more complicated dynamical systems from simple ones. Application building interesting dynamical systems . It's also good because this is by far the shorter of the two applications to present, so we'll be done in 5 minutes. From old ones, or from simple ones. So let me motivate this with an example. What's an example of a simple dynamical system? Everyone's favorite irrational rotation. So you have a circle, you can identify with the unit circle of the complex plane. You have some irrational angle alpha. And I imagine, let's call this space X as my circle. Z acts on the circle by each positive integer just does the irrational rotation. So this is an action of the group Z by homeomorphisms. This is a classic system. Comes up a lot. But it's really simple. It's X is a compact metric space. It's a very simple compact metric space. It's isometric. There's loads of reasons to qualify that this is simple. Yet, by abstract nonsense, there exists really complicated Z systems. So another reason it's simple or nice is that it's minimal. It's a minimal dynamical system, meaning this is a... Maybe I'll define that in a second. But anyways, there's abstract reasons to believe that Z admits tons of interesting dynamical systems, but I would like to build one using X and only X as my ingredient. Sort of a challenge. And we also want to preserve some dynamical information. So, the dynamical information I want to preserve is the following. act on x. X will be compact. This is an action by homeomorphisms. Following are equivalent to this action being minimal. One, every orbit is dense. And two is maybe a little trickier to see, but it's really useful. Every non-empty open set, there are finitely many translates from the group, so that if I translate U by that many group elements, I get back the whole space. So, 2 implies 1 is pretty clear. I fix a U. Let me draw a little diagram. So if I want to do 2, here's my dynamical system. Here's U. Here's a point inside my dynamical system. I want to argue that the orbit gets in to the open set to have dense orbit. Well, I know if I'm assuming 2, finitely many translates cover the whole thing. In particular, if some translate moves you on top of x, then that the inverse of that translate will put x inside u. If we assume 1, well, so every orbit is dense, so I start with a point. I know it lands into this open set somehow. So that means there is a group element moving you onto x. But how do you get down to finitely many? That's kind of the trick. So, yeah, it's a compactness argument. So we have a group element g sub x for every point, g sub x u, unions up to x. This sure looks like an open cover of a compact space. And then you're going to use compactness. So it's useful to keep in mind. So now here is, as promised, a more complicated dynamical system from a simple one. I'm going to take, where'd it go? Here it is. So if G acts on X by homeos, then also get G acting on the stone space of the regular open algebra of X by homeomorphisms. So what's the action? A point inside here is just a collection of regular open sets of the original space. The group is moving around the original space. It'll move around these regular open sets. So it'll move around the ultra filters in a pretty straightforward fashion. So it's going to push all the member sets around. So it's not hard to see this is way more complicated. So even starting from irrational rotation, you get it's a massive space. It has size, I think you get up to like 2 to the continuum. In size, it's not metrizable, it's not equicontinuous, it's just a much more complicated dynamical system. But it's still going to be minimal. So that's the key property we wanted to preserve. So here's the proposition. If x is minimal, so I should say if G acting on, so is G's action on the stone space of the regular open. and 2. We're gonna use them together. So, fix a point in STRO of X and a basic open neighborhood U sub A of the form ultra filters that contain the regular open set A. I want a group element sending P into U sub A. Well, A, let's go back down to X. A is open. It's regular open, so it is open. So let's find those GIs. With their union so now using part of the ultra property of ultra filters so there is an I less than k we covered the whole space infinitely many x is regular open these are regular open they're join is the whole space. I have to find one in the ultra filter. G, I, A, and P. So G, I inverse of P is in U sub A. So as it never. Alright, so that is building a more complicated minimal dynamical system from a simple minimal dynamical system. Alright, I think that's all I'll talk about today, so thank you.
Any questions?
Can you guess what I'm going to ask you?
About functors?
Yes.
Go on.
I feel like you've been dangling some adjunctions in front of me.
I think they're just... Also, Stone and Clop are both contravariant isomorphisms. So I feel like they're adjunctions, but for a really simple, like the simplest possible reason.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, they're inverse. They're inverse functors.
Okay. So if you
they're
take
like literally
so if you take like two Boolean algebras and a homomorphism between them, and you take the Stone spaces.
Yes.
A continuous map any other way.
Mm-hmm. Continuous, let's say the category of continuous surjections.
Okay. And what about regular openness?
Oh, so regular open is a bit trickier.
Right, because that one, so you've got that map IB, go from B to row of Stone of B.
Yes.
That looks a lot to me like a unit of an adjunction.
IB from B to row of Stone.
It looks like Stone should be left adjunct to row.
Oh, that's possible. So I can tell you that extremely disconnected compact spaces, so you'll have to reverse all the arrows, but extremely disconnected compact spaces are exactly the projective objects in the category of compact Hausdorff spaces.
Cool.
So reverse the arrows, and then you get what complete Boolean algebra are.
Yeah.
Right. Yes?
So I don't really know what regular open sets are because I don't know topologies that aren't compact. So for like this example, the Cantor space.
Yes.
Can you tell me like maybe some set which is on that side but not that side?
Oh sure. So for instance, when we talked about. Remember when I showed that Cantor space was not extremely disconnected,
mm-hmm.
and I built that union of basic neighborhoods?
Yeah.
So that union was a regular open set, which was not Clopin. An example of an open set that's not regular open, those are not two arcs, say we have the unit interval, and I just have, like, here's an interval. Intervals are regular open. But then see, I union it with another interval that is just, its start is exactly the endpoint of the other. So then when I take the closure, I'm gonna get the whole thing, then the interior is just gonna forget that there was a gap there. So that's regular open.
So in your application, why did you use the, did you use any completion of the way algebra?
You're bringing up a good point. The only thing I needed about it is that it's an extremely disconnected and disgusting space. So starting with this space, you can do many of the same dynamical things with an extremely disconnected space. And those are interesting to me.